All right. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you are, you know, around the world. My name is Jeff Ge. I'm you know, editor of you know, mechanisms and robotics for JMD. I just joined JMD you know, early this year, and this robotics webinar is the first in the area of machine design and robotics, but it's also the fourth webinar of our journal's webinar series. The first three cover the topics on data-driven, you know, design, team science, and design for additive manufacturing. So what we are about to have is the fourth one. First, I would like to thank Haijun Su and Kyle, you know, Nelson, who, you know, organized this webinar, as well as Faiz Ahmad for, you know, providing technical support and guidance. And Amy, our editorial, you know, assistant, you know, without her, you know, effort, it would not have happened, as well as the ASME staff that provides this webinar platform and all the support that we needed. So without further ado, I will turn it over to Haijun, who is the one of the two organizers of the webinar.
Okay, so let me share my screen. So yeah, thank you for coming to seminar. This seminar will be on the theme of this seminar. The webinar will be robot design, and we have three speakers here. These are the Guanglu Jia, Yu Se, and Andrew Sabel Haas will be the speaker. So I would like to start, you know, about the background of this webinar, why we choose this topic. I want to start with the definition of robot. So a robot is a machine, so it's programmable machine. So, and mechanical design is really the first step for embodiment design of a robot. I believe that, strongly believe that mechanical design really determines the upper bound of the performance of a robot. And well, it's really the hardware design and control is to maximize the performance of robot within the boundary defined by the hardware design. So if you want to push the boundary of the performance of robots, so really mechanical design is probably one of the main approach to. So that's why the mechanical design is a very important aspect for robotics. It's often neglected in the robotics field. They pay a lot of attention to control. That's because most of the end user just get, you know, how they interact with the robot, but they forgot, you know, in the behind, there are a lot of hardware design. So I think that's very important. And, you know, robot design, there are many aspects of robot design. I select a few that very, some of traditional, some of recent research in related to robot design. And this including, you know, classical kinematic dynamic modeling of multi-body system, motion control, kinematic synthesis. This is the design methodology of linkages mechanism for robot. These are really laid out the foundation of the robot design. And recent work has been on, you know, some of the recent work on non-conventional robot, so soft robot, biomimic robot. And these are the also the other lot of design of actuator transmission system that designed for robot system. So if you take a look, you know, some like this is a Festo soft bionic soft robotic hand. That see that there are a lot of design related issues, particularly mechanical design problem challenges related to the robot design. So, and the right one thing is what we are doing in my lab. You know, we're working on the wearable stiff robotic gripper that can changing the stiffness and increase the payload by many times. So that's there are a lot of work we can do and contribute to robotics. So control is not just mechanical design, and it's very important for robot. That's so this webinar will be on robot design, and we have selected three paper from recent publication in ASME Journal of Mechanical Design. So this first paper is related, it's about the design of transformable origami. This design is based on the origami design for transformable mechanism. The leading speaker will be Guanglu Jia. And the second one will be Professor Yi Sir from Purdue University. He's going to talk about how the compliance affected the human-robot interaction, the safety of the human-robot interaction. And the third paper will be on design of a double helix linear actuator. So the speaker will be Professor Andrew Sabel-Haas from Boston University. So these are the three selected one. And today's agenda, so Jeff just give a welcome to the webinar, and I'm giving this overview of the this agenda of this webinar. We have three talks, each will be 20 minutes, so roughly 15 minutes for a talk presentation and 5 minutes for question and answering. And we will have a group photo. Please stay until we finish all three. So, at last, we will have a gathering time about 30 minutes. So if you want to have a in-depth discussion, you can stay, go to this link. I will post this link to a chat later into the webinar. So again, welcome to the fourth seminar, fourth webinar on robot design. Okay.
So yeah, if I may add one more thing, I just want to say that the three papers were selected from a list of top 10 papers in robot design area for the past 2 years, and they are either the top 10 most cited papers or the top 10 most downloaded ones. So I would like to congratulate the speakers for the fine work that they have done.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so should we start? So let's start with the first speaker. Guanglu, you want to share your screen?
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your introduction.
Let me introduce you first. Okay. Yes. So Dr. Guanglu Jia received his Master of Engineering degree and PhD in School of Mechanical Engineering and Automation at Harbin Institute of Technology, Shenzhen, in 2016 and 2020. So he received the national scholarship and was an outstanding graduate of Harbin Institute of Technology. His research interests including metaformic mechanism, origami mechanism, only blocks, Lie algebra, and school theory. And Dr. Jia will soon join the faculty of natural mathematical engineering science at King's College in London as a postdoc researcher. So let's welcome Dr. Jia.
Okay, thank you, Professor Su. Let me share my PowerPoint. Could you see my PowerPoint?
Yes, I can.
Okay. Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm Guangru Jia. It's my great honor to make a report at this webinar. Our topic is about designing Ori blocks. The related work has been published in JMD. And I'll make this report by following this outline. I'll introduce the background. And then I process the concept. Provide the concept of Ori blocks, and then I'll show how to design cylindrical Ori blocks and conical Ori blocks. In the last part, I'll show the application of these Ori blocks. And the first part is about background. Origami is a very famous paper folding art, which doesn't consider the material thickness. However, as we know, in the field of engineering, such as mechanisms and robots, the material thickness can't be neglected. So in recent years, several researchers processed some thickness accommodation techniques to design thick origamis. These thick origamis consider the material thickness. To make it clear, I select three examples to show these thickness accommodation techniques. The first one is tapered panels technique. There are several features in it. The zero thickness surface still exists, and the thickness is added around the zero thickness surface, and the material is added equally, which can be seen in the middle picture. This method starts from a zero thickness model. After we add thickness and taper to rotational axis, then we can obtain the thick origami. This thick origami can be folded from the deployed state into its stored state, which can be seen in the right picture of this slide. And the second one is offset panel technique, which positions the panels away from the zero thickness surface, and all the rotational axis align with the same plane. This method also creates an equivalent mechanism. This picture presents this technique. Offset panel method also starts from a zero thickness model, and the zero thickness surface is denoted by using the red line. And after adding thickness and offsetting thick panels, we can create a thick origami. And the right picture illustrates the folding process of this thick origami. And this is the deployed state, and this is the stored state. The last example is a hinge shift technique, which shifts the location of the rotational axis. This method moves the joint axis as called axis shift technique. This method makes the connection between spatial linkage and thick origamis. And this picture presents how to design thick origamis using this method. This method is also proposed based on a zero thickness model. After adding thickness and shifting rotational axis, we can create a thick origami. And this thick origami can be folded into the stored state. Of course, there are other thickness accommodation techniques it can be seen from this picture that in the first step, all thickness accommodation techniques start from a zero thickness model, and the second step is adding thickness. So we can find that there are some limitations in thickness accommodation technique. The first limitation is that all these methods are based on zero thickness model, namely two dimensional material. And the second limitation is that all rotational axes parallel to a particular plane. Although some thickness accommodation techniques build connections between thick origamis and some spatial linkage. However, not all spatial linkage can be derived from these thick origamis. In order to address these issues, we design OriBlocks. Hinge decisions give us some inspirations. Hinged decisions are decisions where pieces are hinged together at vertices. They are transformable to dimensional material. A simple hinge decision can be seen in the top picture. This hinge decision has four pieces, and these pieces are hinged at three vertices. These hinge decisions can be transformed from a square to a triangle. Based on the concept of hinge decisions, we designed OriBlocks. OriBlocks are reconfigurable block-based mechanism, where Ori is derived from the word origami in its original meaning of folding. OriBlocks are designed based on solid geometries, which means that OriBlocks can be constructed from three-dimensional materials. The pieces are hinged together at edges instead of vertices by comparing with the hinged decisions. And the bottom pictures illustrate the design process of an ORI block. First, we divide the solid geometry into several parts, then we allocate some rotational axes. After material trimming, we can obtain the ORI block. And this ORI block can be folded from its deployed state into its stored state. In order to make the design process of OriBlocks clear, we select a cylinder and a cone to show how to design cylindrical OriBlock and conical OriBlock. The first type of OriBlock is cylindrical OriBlock. Here, we select a cylinder. Then we divide it into six portions, and we assign six rotational axes. Four rotational axes intersect at the same part, and the other two are parallel to each other and are also perpendicular to the surface of panels. This picture illustrates DH coordinate frame of a cylindrical ORI block. We derived closed equations of this cylindrical ORI block. According to these formulas, we can obtain these two kinematic curves as seen in these pictures, which means that the cylindrical ORI block has two motion branches, but we just consider the second case. The bottom pictures illustrate how to use the cylindrical ORI block to derive a plane symmetrical breakout linkage. And these two pictures illustrate the folding manners of a cylindrical array block and the folding manners of a plane symmetric symmetric breakout linkage. Comparing these two pictures, we can find that a cylindrical array block and the plane symmetric breakout linkage are equivalent mechanisms. We provide an animation to reveal that the cylindrical array block has the same folding manners as a plane symmetric breakout linkage. And we also process the three-dimensional printing model, which can be seen in this animation. The second array block is a conical array block. First, we select a cone, then we divide this cone into several parts, and we remove this pink part. We cut the remaining part into six portions, and we also assign six rotational axes. Here, three rotational axes intersect at the same point, and the other three parallel to each other and are perpendicular to the top surface of the cone. We also calculated the closed equations of this conical array block by applying DH method. According to these equations, we can obtain these two kinematic curves. We can find that this conical array block has two motion branches. In addition, the bottom pictures present the conical array block can be used to derive three-fold symmetric breakout linkage. And these two pictures shows the kinematic behaviors of a conical array block and the three-fold symmetric breakout linkage. Comparing these two pictures, we can find that these two mechanisms are equivalent mechanisms. These animations is used to demonstrate that the conical array block has the same behavior as the three-fold symmetric breakout linkage. Finally, we also process the three-dimensional printing model. And in the last part is about applications. Here, we select three examples to show the applications of these array blocks. First, we design units based on array blocks. The units can be constructed based on a cylindrical array block, and also can be created based on a conical array block, which can be seen in these pictures. And we also proposed the connection method to design single degree of freedom deployable mechanisms. And in the first application, we can design deployable mechanisms as seen in this animation. We designed some sub mechanisms using cylindrical array blocks by connecting specific portions. And this is the folding process, and this is the deploying process. Finally, we can create a new type of deployable mechanisms by connecting or sharing specific portions. We also provide an animation to show its deploying motion. And this is the deployed state of this deployable mechanism. And the second application is designing metal material. Here, we also design new submechanisms using surgical early blows by applying connection method, as seen in this animation. And this is the design process of submechanism 6. And this is about the design of submechanism 7. And this is the folding process, and this is the deploying process. Finally, we create a new type of metal material. In order to make it clear, we provide three views to show this process. In addition, we also provide animation to show its motion type of this metal material. In the last example, we use conical ori block to design metal material, which can be seen in this animation. And we can create a new submechanism using conical ori blocks. Finally, we create a new kind of metal material by sharing specific ori blocks. And in this animation, we can see the motion type of this metal material. In a sum, we just select three examples to show the applications of ori blocks. And that's all. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact with me. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your interesting work. So is there any question from audience? Yeah. So how do I know if there anybody have a question? So
I raise a hand.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I thought it's okay. Yeah, you can go ahead. Yeah.
Great, great. Yeah, thanks, Guanglu, for introducing this great, great work. Yeah, I feel it's very interesting. Just one thought. When you mentioned you get the closed form, kinematics closed form with the, I think it's a canonical ori block. So you have three axes parallel. And the three axes has intersection. Is that reason to develop the canonical form? Because maybe you want three axes parallel and the three axes intersection so that you can get a closed form. Yeah, my question is kind of, how did you get this? How did you have the idea to develop this canonical ori block? Is because of the kinematic constraint? Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your question. When I design cylindrical ori blocks and conical ori blocks, I just consider the features of this solid geometry. For example, there are distinct differences between a cylinder and a cone. Because as we know, the line, the line in a, several lines in a conic in a cylinder which are parallel to each other. However, in a cone, the line intersect at the same point. So I find that there are several differences between these two solid geometry. So I divide this solid geometry into six portions and try to assign rotational axis to make it hide the mobility to work. Yes. Of course, I also Of course, the breakout linkage is a very famous our constrained linkage. Yes. I also try to build the connections between this spatial linkage and the ORI blocks.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I have a sub question from Wei Chen. What type of information of the unit block metamaterial do you need to create the material system?
Please pardon me.
Yeah, the second question from Wei Chen. So she's asking what type of information of the unit block metamaterial do you need to create the metamaterial system? So if you have the unit block, and then how do you, what kind of information do you need to actually form the metamaterial system? How you pattern it? How you assemble them together? What kind of information do you need?
Thank you for your questions. When I designed these ORI blocks, then I try to assemble these ORI blocks like origami, because as we know, origami inspired mechanism or origami robots have wide applications. So I should develop these ORI blocks to large scale mechanism or robot. But how to assemble this ORI block? Before I try to assemble this ORI block, I have completed the kinematic analysis of this ORI blocks. So I found the features during the move. I try to assemble these ORI blocks. Then I find they can be assembled very well based on the kinematic analysis. Thank you.
Okay, there's another question from this is probably the last one. I have more questions, but I can ask later. But this is a question from Guangbo Hao. How do you avoid interference of different rigid parts in your prototype?
Okay, thank you very much. When I design these ORI blocks, at the first time, I didn't consider how to avoid the intersection, because when I cut this ORI block and try it have the mobility to be morbid. Then I find for example, for a cylindrical ORI block, I don't need remove any material because there is no any self intersection. However, when I design the conical ORI block, I find there are some materials intersected. I just to remove these materials using software.
Okay, thank you. Okay, let's give Dr. Ja a pause. Thank you for your talk presentation. Very nice work. So we have to move on to the next speaker. Can you share screen while I'm introduce you? Okay, Yi Sir is an assistant professor at Purdue University for School of Industrial Engineering. So before that, he was a postdoc at MIT and earned his PhD from Ohio State. And his current research has been at in the section of mechanical design, sensory perception, and dynamic control. He is interested also in human safe collaborative robots, soft robotics, and robotic manipulation. So he received a number of awards, including a presidential fellowship at Ohio State, recipient of Best Paper Award, honorary mention for the 2020 Journal for Mechanical Design, Mechanical Robotics, Best Paper finalist at 2020 Robotics Science and System Conference, the Best Paper Award at the 2018 ASME Dynamic Control Conference, and the Best Paper finalist at the 2013 IEEE Conference on Robotics and Biomimetics. So let's welcome Dr. Sir to give his talk.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Su, for your introduction. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great, great. Yeah, so so first, thank you all joined this webinar on robot design, and thank the organizers for offering this great opportunity. So today is my great honor to be here to share with you some of my recent work. It's titled A Comparative Study on the Effect of Mechanical Compliance for Safe Physical Human-Robot Interaction. My name is Yu. I'm an assistant professor at Purdue University. And this work is a joint work with Dr. Siyang Song, Professor Haijun Su, and Professor Jimin Wang. I would like to start with a little bit background introduction in this field, like collaborative robots or human-robot interaction. So we need conventional industrial robots. They are made by rigid material. They are fast, strong, precise, and they're widely deployed in industrial factories to build cars, but they are not that safe for physical human-robot interaction. And that's the reason they are put in the cage to physically isolate it from human. So on the contrary, soft robots, they guarantee safety. They made by soft material, they will deform upon impact, but the performance is not as good as those like rigid industrial robots. For example, the payload and accuracy maybe not as good as rigid robots. So is there any way we can leverage both the advantage for rigid robots and soft robots? So people recently study variable stiffening mechanisms. This is one of the options that may, you know, leverage both advantage for rigid robots and soft robots. So the goal for variable stiffening mechanisms is to develop a safe and high performing robots. So what is variable stiffness? So now I will like give very brief introduce about variable stiffness. So now if we consider a very simple robotic manipulation task, pick and place, we want to move objects from position A to position B. And ideally we want to run as fast as possible, but it may hit and hurt a human. We don't want it. And on the contrary, we can ask the robots to run very slow to guarantee safety. However, we don't like it either because the time efficiency is not optimized. So now here come to the variable stiffness, it plays a role here. So now we first consider this potential impact force is affected by the robot velocity, robot stiffness, and the inertia of the robots and the payload. So if we only consider the stiffness and the velocity for now, then we have this plot. So the impact force affected by these all parameters, and the velocity is what we already discussed. We want to go from zero to maximum speed and go to zero to have the maximum time efficiency. So if we can tune the stiffness of the robot according to the robot velocity, then we can make sure the potential impact force will be lower than safety threshold. So this is how this variable stiffness concept works. And variable stiffness usually has two major approach or method. algorithm-based solution and mechanical-based solution. So the algorithm-based solution, really like the variable impedance control, they require very a bunch of data, sensor data, and also very accurate modeling for the entire system, which could be very challenging for a complex robotic system. For example, the friction force is very difficult for modeling. And the mechanical-based solution is more on the hardware side. And it has two major categories, like variable stiffness joint and variable stiffness link. If the variable stiffness is designed in the robotic joint, it's called variable stiffness joint. If the variable stiffness is designed in the robotic link, it's variable stiffness link. Now questions becomes, which one is more effective? Because now we have two options. And how design parameters affect the performers to improve safety, reduce impact force, which design parameters are more effective and how effective reducing this impact force. So those are the questions we are going to explore in this paper. We start from system modeling. And so now let's consider a very simple case, the most simple robots, one robotic link, one joint. So we have a robot, we have like a dummy head, and the neck and the neck neck springs, and this impact occurs. So there has three major components for this modeling: the robot dynamics and the contact model and the head dynamics. So for the contact model, we consider the Hertz contact model, and now we have multi-material for the impact. So we consider the piecewise Hertz contact model, because as we can see, we have like a skins on the surface of bones and covering on the top of the end effector. So this different material property will, you know, the impact force or contact force will be kind of depend on the material property and the geometries of this, the contact surface. And the impact force basically is a relation on the penetration, which is represented by the data. So this is a plot for this impact force with respect to the penetration, which is three regions and the non-linear curve. We come back to the system modeling for this component joint for this robot system. So for the robot dynamics, very straightforward. We use the Lagrangian equation and the same for the dummy head. So the piecewise Hertz contact model actually played a role here. We have the contact force and penetration represented by here. So this one is about the component joint design. So we have component joint here, reach the link here. If we change the stiffness of this component joint, it becomes a variable stiffness joint, right? So next, we consider component link design. So now we have component link and reach the joint here. And if we change the stiffness of the component link, it becomes a variable stiffness link. And we model the robot dynamics with assumed mode method. And we consider the first two modes, vibration mode or like the first two natural frequency for this modeling. And then the Lagrangian for the head dynamics, dummy head dynamics. And these are the, the Hertz connected model. So, now we have two different systems, component joint design and component link design. So the reach the link here, component joint here, component link here, reach the joint here. So we are going to compare these two systems, which one is more effective, which one is better to design like safe, design the robot for safe physical human robot interaction. So now let's first validate the model for this component joint model. The dash lines are the calculation result from the theoretical model we just represent. And this continue line is the result from the MATLAB multi-body simulation platform. Previously it's called a Sync Mechanics. Now it's called a Sync Skype. So we found the model agrees with our, the simulation from the multi-body dynamic simulation platform agree with the result from our theoretical model. And we compare these two designs. So this is the reached link component joint design. And this is a component link reached joint design. And here we give all the same parameters and give an impact and see what what's the performance of the impact force. So now we have the same torque applied to these two systems, the same mass of the robotic link, the same mass of the end effector, and the same impact speed. And turns out the impact force from this compliant link design is smaller than the rigid link design, a compliant joint design. So yeah, this is one observation we found, and we think this is reasonable and explainable because of the reflected inertia decoupling. So now let's first consider this compliant joint design. And if there's impact, this compliant joint will decouple the motor inertia to the reflected impact force. So that way, when we calculated the impact force, only this portion from the link, from the payload will reflect that to the impact force. Now, if we consider compliant link design, things are a little bit different. So this is the compliant link design. And now we make an equivalent system. Say we use like a finite segment method, like hundreds of thousands of torsional springs connected by different links. So when we have impact, the compliant joint here, they kind of not only decouple the inertia from the motor here, but also decouple part of the inertia from the robotic link itself. So that's the reason why it creates a little bit of smaller impact force. So yeah, this is the reasoning behind the small impact force for the compliant link design. And so there are multiple parameters affect this impact force. So this impact force profile, in actual situation, it have multiple waves, but here we only consider the first wave, which has the largest impact force. And the parameters include the robot stiffness, a mass of payload, the ratio of the pass payload over the mass of a link, and the motor torque, robot velocity, or the impact velocity. We consider more about the robot stiffness in this work because we are thinking about variable stiffness design to reduce impact force for safe physical human robot interaction. So for this plot, each stiffness, we will have this profile of the impact force, and it has a maximum impact force. If we give multiple stiffness, then we will have multiple impact force, right? So we want to build a map, or we want to find the map, the maximum impact force versus the robot stiffness. Ideally, if we can reduce the robot stiffness, we want the impact force or the maximum impact force reduce. That's what we want. And if this is a linear or nonlinear relation, we don't know. We are going to explore later. And here is a simulation result from the theoretical modeling I presented early. And so the x-axis is the lateral stiffness we represent by the logarithm representation, because we will see a much clearer change here. And on the y-axis is the maximum impact force. So this is a variable stiffness joint design or compliant joint design. So now we have different velocities. We try different velocities. For this velocity equals to 5 meters per second, we reduce the lateral stiffness, and we didn't observe any impact force reduction. And the same applies to other velocities. Actually, this is reasonable because we mentioned previously the compliant joint will decouple the motor's inertia. So change the stiffness won't affect the maximum impact force for the compliant joint design. So now let's consider this variable stiffness link design or the compliant link design. So now we start here, the same velocity, v equals to 5 per second, and we reduce this lateral stiffness, and we clearly see there is a reduction of the maximum impact force. That's exactly what we are looking for. We want to, you know, achieve the impact force reduction by reducing the stiffness, right? That's what we are looking for. It's great to see we found this phenomena. And the same applies to other different velocities. So we also tried the different other parameter. Now we give a bunch of different the mass ratio. I mean the mass of the payload over the mass of the link. And here, this is for the variable stiffness joint design or the compliant joint design. We didn't observe any maximal impact force reduction but if we reduce the lateral stiffness. But we do find the impact force reduction on the variable stiffness link. So yeah, this is the other design, other simulation given different the payload. So yeah, so we found that this variable stiffness link is more effective to reduce impact force. So the last simulation is about the variable stiffness joint. I mean about the, we changed different torques. And it is interesting to see even for this variable stiffness joint, we can achieve some like impact force reduction when we reduce the impact force here. We do see some like impact force reduction for this compliant joint design. That's maybe partially, you know, due to the torque applied, maybe reflected to the impact force. But still, if we consider the variable stiffness link design, we have much larger impact force reduction. So, we have a few parameters to evaluate this performance. So for this compliant link design, we do find there's a clear trend, like the reduction of the robot stiffness and the impact force, right? By reducing this robot stiffness, we will observe the maximum impact force reduction. And this is kind of a sigmoid function. And there are three parameters we are interested. First, how much the reduction we can achieve. We want to as large as possible, and how quick it can change, like the derivative of this curve, because we want to use minimal efforts, minimal robot stiffness variation to achieve the maximum impact force reduction. That's the kind of optimal goal, right? And also, what is the critical value for this lateral for the robot stiffness? Because not only this relative variable stiffness, but we also need the absolute value. Is this feasible? Is possible we can design a mechanism using 3D printed material, or is possible we can use metal material to design this? We need some like absolute value to guide us for the design. So here are some like simulation result from the modeling. We have the impact force reduction, the derivative of the reduction, and the critical value. And this is give different payload simulation. This is give different torque simulation. So this result can give us some guidance how to design robots. So for example, we want like 50% reduction of the impact force, which parameter we are supposed to select, and give this particular value of this, so the critical value of this lateral stiffness, we will select the material for the robots, like the dimension, the width, the cross section, and yeah, the material property. So yeah, finally, a few takeaways. From this research, we found the compliant link design potentially outperforms the compliant joint design. It have a small impact force, and it is more effective in reducing impact force. And we also found this impact force reduction is only prominent in a certain range of the lateral stiffness variation, just like a sigmoid function. And yeah, that's all from my presentation. Yeah, thank you. And I would happy to take any question you may have. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for your talk. So we have one question from Bin Zi. So he's asking, how would the robot behave when interacting with a multi-joint object, say a human arm or hand? It's not just one body. Well, I know that your object is modeled as like head, right? Head model.
Yes.
But what about the hand interacting?
Yes. Yeah. So yeah, great question. So I think the method will be the same, but the modeling from the human dummy head side will be a little bit different. So then, which means we need a modeling for the multi-body of the the object side. So here we only consider these the single the head and the neck. But the, I think the overall conclusion will be also the same. The overall conclusion will be very similar, but the quantity may be a little bit different because we will update the modeling for the object side. Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
So this is a question from Guo Wu. Okay. How about if we combine both combine join and link? What do you think? I know. Do you think that you can have a hello?
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, I'm thinking about this question. Yeah, this fantastic question. I actually explored a little bit on this flexible join and flexible link before. So I think definitely it will be an interesting idea to explore. For the compliant join, I feel, for example, people develop this compliant join SEA for the Baxter, right? The compliant join actually, you know, it makes difficult for precise control, the gripping the objects. It's mostly used for the feedback, talk feedback. If we combine these two, I think it will be interesting to explore, but I do not have immediately thought about like the advantages compared to the compliant link. Yeah, but yeah, it'll be interesting to explore. We can discuss later, yeah.
So yeah, I think Andrew has one question. Go ahead. I didn't see your hand. So
yeah, sorry. It's all right. No problem. Thank you, Dr. Shu. This is really interesting work, and my understanding is that there's actually really deep implications here for when we talk about designing, in particular, something like soft robots. And what I'm thinking about is that there's this big result with respect to stiffness and tracking performance that I think came out of Cosimo Della Santina's group back in like 2017 or so, that showed this inverse relationship where if the robot, if you're making a compliant or flexible robot and it's more compliant or flexible, there's inherently less ability to have it track a position with lower error, right? The more flexible you make it, the worse your control is going to get necessarily, and you can go improve that. And it seems like from what your result is showing is that with the same amount of stiffness, one could get safer behavior by building the link with that compliance rather than the join. So it's kind of like, it sounds almost like a way to get around that issue where one could get potentially better tracking performance with the, you know, with something that's kind of like in a sense a bit stiffer or so, but just with the design in a different part of the robot.
Yeah, this is a very good question. Very good point. I'm not sure I totally get the idea, but I think I can comment a little bit. So here, the reason we can get this better performance using compliant link is because we considered from the decoupling side. So I mentioned that if we are considering compliant joint, it will, the compliance will decouple the motor's inertia from the impact force, right? So this is because of the inertia decoupling. So now let's come back to the motion tracking or the like position control, force control. I'm actually not sure if I get a better performance because this is not like inertia decoupling. It's more about kinematics. Yeah, I'm not sure, but it's very interesting. It's an interesting topic. Yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to talk with you later about it. Thanks.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so I think we probably don't have more time, but if you have more questions, we can move to the gathering town and ask the speaker in more depth, you know. So, okay, we're gonna move to the third one. So I'm gonna hand over to Professor Carl Nelson. Is gonna introduce the third speaker. Carl?
Hi, everybody. Our third speaker is Drew Sablehouse. We know him now because he's asked questions. So throwing himself already under the bus a little bit. Professor Sablehouse is an assistant professor, a new assistant professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering at Boston University. And he got his PhD in mechanical engineering at the University of California, Berkeley. in 2019 and worked with NASA Ames on their intelligent robotics group. From 2019 to 2021, he was a postdoc at Carnegie Mellon University. In his bio, it says intelligence community postdoctoral research fellow. So I'm not sure what intelligence community implies there, but it sounds interesting. He had a NASA Space Technology Research Fellowship and an NSF Graduate Research Fellowship as part of his studies along the way. So really neat accomplishments there. His research takes a control-oriented approach to the locomotion of soft and flexible robots. That's the comment and question just a few minutes ago. And this spans problems in modeling, feedback, and mechanical design. So Professor Sablehouse, please go ahead with your presentation. Looking forward to it.
Absolutely. Thank you for that introduction. The intelligence community part is more just the name of the fellowship. And it's one of those where it has to be said. So contractually. Cool. I'll go ahead and share my screen and then start the slideshow. Okay. And the video is running. Cool. All right. I'll start the timer for myself too, so I'll stay on time. So thanks again. My name is Andrew Sablehouse. I go by Drew. My pronouns are he and him. I am starting as an assistant professor at Boston University in 2022. And I am really excited to get the chance to talk to you all about some work that I did with collaborators at Berkeley and NASA Ames on a new type of linear actuator designed for, in particular, mobile robots that need large amounts of motion in very compact spaces. And so this video here is the one to keep in mind throughout this talk. It's a flexible collapsing mechanism where there are two edges that take the shape of helices. Therefore, the name double helix linear actuator. So today I want to spend most of the time on this talk just motivating the problem and talking about our particular solution to it. And with a little bit at the end of the sort of conclusions with respect to concepts and, or rather the analytical models and the conclusions that we make from them, mostly because hopefully if I get you all interested in this stuff, there's a lot of the details in the article. So motivation, inspiration, concepts themselves, and then the mechanical tests and characterization. So motivation for this work. Generating motion for a mobile robot, particularly one that is either untethered or lightly tethered, if you will, is always a perennial challenge, particularly when it comes to robots that have some kind of inherent flexibility. So examples of these kinds of challenges include, for example, the tensegrity robot on the left-hand side of this video that was made by some of my collaborators at NASA that locomotes by adjusting the lengths and effectively the stiffnesses of the cables that hold its structure together in order to take these little steps. And even more traditional robots that have rigid components but flexible joints, like Professor Shah's work, still have these very, very complicated types of mechanisms. As an example, this biped robot from Michigan here. And one of the commonalities between those particular types of robots is that cables are a very efficient way to create this type of mechanism, but cables themselves are relatively challenging to retract to the amount of displacement that we would like with the amount of forces we would like in the amount of compact space that's available on one of these robots. So as an example, for those tensegrity robots to pack and unpack, there is an enormous amount of cable that needs to be spooled up into the spools that we've designed, which creates sort of so many different challenges with modeling of what is then the effective diameter of your spool and things like that. And for these robots, 90% of the mechanical design work went into the cable mechanisms. And even for something that's currently tethered, like for example, a manipulator, there's still a large amount of actuation that kind of has to happen close and around it. And so taking these types of things, removing the spools, something like that to make these robots more mobile, would be a huge help for deploying these robots out in the real world. So there's a number of prior research studies that have tried to create mechanisms like this, in particular for cables. And I'd like to go through a couple to motivate our particular variation on this topic. The first one is a very popular idea called twisted string actuation or twisted cable actuation. This comes in a variety of different forms, but the underlying concept is if we have two flexible elements, two or more flexible elements laid up against each other, and we constrain one end and rotate the other end, the cables or strings or wires twist onto themselves and the total length decreases as this helix angle ends up changing. This allows for a very large transmission of force, and it's very compact because the mechanism collapses in on itself. The trouble with this is that there isn't a lot of length change that can end up happening because these helix angles, they can't ever really get very steep. Because of just the mechanical constraints. So roughly speaking, it's about 30% displacement for the best of these actuators, which wasn't nearly enough for our tensegrity robots. An alternative here would be to consider collapsing frames themselves. Maybe we don't necessarily need strings or something like that, but create another type of mechanism that does this collapsing type of behavior. And there has been prior work on things like this, mostly applied to, for example, antennas and things of that sort, where folks are mostly interested in stability properties, where there's one stable configuration where the mechanism is entirely extended, in other words, entirely contracted, but there hasn't been much work considering how this might be used to generate motion in the first place, when a torque, for example, is applied to one end, despite the fact that there is a very, very large amount of length change here. There are still other types of designs that try and maybe find a balance between these types of concepts. And here's one, in fact, from ASME's Journal of Mechanical Design that tried to have multiple strings in these hoops that would do a similar type of motion. And for something like this, we still get this large force transfer and compact design. The stroke length seemed to be a bit of a challenge, but still the mechanical complexity was there. And there, it's not necessarily clear if this provides a obvious advantage over just spooling in something over a cable. You can imagine, you know, threading all these different cables in this mechanism would be extremely challenging for assembly. So our concept here comes from a marriage of these two effectively somewhat separate ideas of collapsing frames and twisted cable or twisted string actuation. Which can be viewed from the two different perspectives. One of, if we took one of these twisted string actuators and just made the helix radius larger, then for the same angle of twist, we get a larger displacement. So that's the figure on the bottom left here. Or equivalently, we could think about this as let's take one of these collapsing frame ideas and make it stiff enough to actually form a helix. And we have two of these prototypes, for example, on the right-hand side that illustrate both of these two different concepts. Now, one of the things that this article ends up showing is that these two concepts are equivalent in some sense mathematically, at least in the limit as one approaches the other. And as a result, there are a number of design implications and considerations that are somewhat similar between them. However, the performance is extremely different. And we have both a mathematical model and some tests that end up showing the property. So for concepts and analytical models, these two images, you can determine in a sense, the one on the top has this continuous helix type of motion as these edges deform. And on the bottom, if we, for example, use some of these spacers to keep two strings or flexible cables apart, then we have, ideally, the cable would form a little bit of a straight line segment in between its attachment points, because cables, if they're perfectly flexible, would follow the path of a straight line. And so we came up with two different models corresponding to those different situations. We call them continuous and discretized. And we're using the term rails here to refer to those elements on the end, either the wires or that flexible piece of metal. And on the one hand, this just becomes an equation of a helix. On the other hand, this is a stacking up of the displacement between adjacent little segments of the discretized rail. And we come up with an expression for length in the end for both of them. Now we can go and plot those and examine what ends up happening just at high level here. And on the figure on the left-hand side, we show two different designs that have the same geometry, the same length and width and all those types of things. But one is this continuous and one of this is this discretized. We see first an observation that for small displacements, these are somewhat equivalent. The length change is somewhat similar. That's frame B. However, as the displacement gets even larger, first, we could theoretically get a large amount of displacement, potentially without the mechanism colliding with itself. However, the amount of displacement generated is very different between the two. And we can ask, would one be more beneficial than another? On the right-hand side, the red lines are this discretized version of the blue line continuous actuator. And these are for the same geometries. And you can tell that for every one of those geometries, this continuous version, in a sense, collapses faster than this one with these discretized rungs with straight line segments between them. Now, here's the interesting part with performance. One could consider how this changes, how the amount of length change varies as the actuator contracts. And what we end up seeing here is that for these discretized versions, this change in what we are thinking of as transmission ratio, in a sense, is much smaller. But for the continuous rails, this helix one, this change drops off dramatically. So as the mechanism contracts, a very small amount of rotation creates a very large change in its linear displacement. And so we can infer from a mechanical design perspective, if we were to do something like attach a DC motor to one end of this, considering something like these motors can only apply a maximum torque before they stall out, one could imagine that this continuous rails version is going to stall out at these displacements a lot faster, in a sense, than the discretized version. So to get a mechanism that could do the amount of contraction we would like without stalling out a motor, the discretized version might be more beneficial. Now, at the same time, one can end up asking, is there some kind of similarity between these? And we actually went and showed that, was if we take this equation for length and just say this discretization approaches infinity, right, as these number of little spacers end up becoming more or less continuous, the equation for length for the one becomes the equation of length for the other. And therefore, all those other properties about things like their differential kinematics drop out of that in the same way. So one could imagine if we were to go and design a robot based on this, we could go and use this property to determine, for example, what geometry we would need, right? How many of these little rungs we would need for one to have the properties that we would end up needing. So this is relatively promising with respect to going and building some of these designs. Now let's go and do so and see if they end up matching our model. Well, the first one that we built was this potentially more beneficial discretized rails prototype, for which we thought a relatively simple idea, adapting hoop-based design, was just to take some wires and put little spacers in between them and screw down the ends. One of the things that we end up seeing with this is that there's a mechanical instability that occurs even at relatively small amounts of displacement. Because considering this in one's mind, you can imagine that as this rotates, those cables, their angle at which they exit a rung changes in the opposite direction of its pair on the other side, which means that these cables, if there's any kind of stiffness in them at all, which these wire rails do have, they're going to be deformed into a little bit of a sigmoidal shape, as opposed to just maintaining their theoretical straight line. What this means is that at some point, the lowest energy state is just two of those rungs collapsing together and everything else remaining straight. So in order to get a design that would be stable, we would have to have each of these rungs rotate with respect to their cables. And because inserting four different bearings per rung seemed relatively challenging for a design like this, we considered whether from a assembly and construction perspective, the continuous Rails version might be more beneficial, which indeed it was, because one of the things we could do is just take thin strips of material. In this case, we just used spring steel and cut holes in it and loosely attach these spacers, which naturally creates that rotation that would be required, which means now that this design does not have that instability. So we see for this one that despite what we saw with the sort of theoretical model, we do still get these very, very large displacements. And it's much simpler to go and design, even though, you know, there's this theoretical similarity. One of the things we did then was just for the unloaded actuator, that one that I showed in the previous slide, we went and asked if the kinematics were indeed this simplified model, and it matches exceptionally well. This actuator without a load applied at the tip is indeed just a helix. And this has deep implications for if we were to go and do a stress analysis for how much it might deform under load, and asking questions about maybe, for example, is this model close enough somehow or things like that. Now, the last thing we did with these was go and actually test prototypes of a number of different thicknesses and geometries and widths and things like that with different loads at the tip. So this is in place of running an in-depth stress analysis. We just went and asked, how will this work in hardware? And we see a couple important things from this. One is that multi-stable type of motion from the extending antenna is present here also. You can see in the unloaded case, which is the force torque test on the left-hand side, the green line with no hanging weight from the tip of the device, we see a point at which the input torque is maximized, required to keep the actuator in a certain state. So on, for example, less than about 6 radians or so of rotation, this actuator will extend back out to its completely flat state. And ideally, you know, ignoring frictional issues for the moment, at least theoretically, if this actuator is collapsed more than, you know, maybe about 8 radians or so, it'll continue to collapse to its completely collapsed state, which means in a sense, there's some type of energy being input into the system as we end up applying these rotations. So that's not particularly beneficial with respect to something like efficiency. So on the right-hand side, you can see a minimum of just efficiency in terms of work, input work, output work at this point in space. But this does increase with applied load. So there's, in a sense, this maybe some element of superposition going on in here with respect to applied load versus the stresses that are internal to these flexible rails. And that maybe with some future work, one could imagine finding a good balance of these types of designs. So we think this is really promising because this design is compact, it's simple, it's potentially easy to implement, and it can have these large forces that we're interested in. And with a little bit more work on maybe some of these mechanical things, maybe with a more in-depth stress analysis, we could come up with something that has a high enough efficiency for us to go and realistically want to go and use on a mobile robot to adjust the lengths of its cables. So that is that design. The last thing that I just wanted to show was an advertisement for the new group that I'm starting at Boston University this upcoming spring. Interestingly enough, no one has claimed the name Soft Robotics Control Lab for a research lab yet. So that's what my group is going to be called. And here's a number of interesting robot videos of work that I've been doing more recently than this DNA structure, or sorry, this double helix linear actuator on controlling soft robots for a number of different tasks. So that's all I've got. And I'd love to take your questions.
All right, let's see if I can see hands. All right, we have a couple hands. We can start with Jeff.
Oh, hi. I meant to clap my hand, but.
Yes, you were clapping, sorry. You look so similar.
Right, yeah, look. So the efficiency chart that you have shown towards the end, I noticed that when it has no load, your efficiency is basically zero, right? It seems to be that chart indicating. And then as the load gets higher and, you know, efficiency gets higher, you know, as well, I think this is probably because the energy it will take to create the deformation is, you know, proportional to the amount that you have. So it takes a sort of a fixed amount of energy to create some, you know, deformation. So the question is, now, if you know what the load range gonna be, what will be the, you know, spring constant that you will pick so that you will match and have a maximum efficiency?
Yes, absolutely. That is our interpretation also. Yeah, the unloaded line was interesting because we just did a little calculation of load of linear force times linear displacement with zero force. We get, you know, zero efficiency. But it is 100% true that the ratio of energy that is needed to deform the structure versus the energy that is needed to actually displace a load, that ratio, you know, becomes much, much smaller as that load increases, right? So that is one of the reasons why we think this is pretty promising, in particular because, you know, this like 4 Newton load or so is actually very small in comparison to the types of cables and the forces on them that we would need, for example, for that really big tensor gravity robot. Now, that question about what stiffness do we end up needing, that was one where we are hypothesizing that one probably needs more in-depth stress analysis for this type of structure to get a better answer. Because one of the things that ended up happening was that as this load increased, the flexible rails, you know, their flexibility became more relevant, and it wasn't necessarily just a helix. And there's some complicated things going on. And you can see that a bit in this art in the picture there, where some of these rails are a bit stretched out a little bit more than they would have looked otherwise without a load. So in a sense, the answer here is to be determined. But what we can say is that choosing a variety of different materials, we tried out some nylons and some spring steels of varying thicknesses, that there is some answer somewhere there, even if it's just one that's determined by, you know, sort of testing and checking different types of these materials.
All right, next question comes from Venkata Subramanian.
Yep, thank you. Very nice talk. It was very interesting, the design and all of that. I just had a couple of questions about the design itself, and you talked about wanting to do applications in restricted areas, right? In smaller areas. So how feasible, or have you thought of an approach where you can get away with that guiding rail that you have, like in this picture at the bottom, or the one through the middle, to make it even more compact? Is that really feasible? And maybe a slightly separate question, like, have you considered things like origami-based kinematics models that would maybe achieve something similar, but perhaps more difficult to actuate? So just wondering what your thoughts were on that.
Yeah, those are both great questions. And this rail, that constraining rail, or in this case, we had some linear bearings on some rods. Both is exactly as you say, the current, you know, barrier in a sense to have this frame be completely collapsing. Now, one of the things with this, one of the reasons why we justified that this wasn't necessarily too much of a problem at the moment, is that if one was to go and build one of these mechanisms into a robot, the sort of volumetric space that it would need to take up, that the actuator would need to take up anyway, would be in its fully extended configuration. So for example, if we had one of these tensegrity robots, let me get a good picture of it. One of these tensegrity robots that had these rods there, one could imagine putting the mechanism inside the rod and not necessarily needing to have the rail adjust also, because the rail inside this tube is relatively fixed. So we said that's, you know, relatively speaking, that's future work, probably because it won't influence the mechanical design too much. Now that said, it still would be important to consider how we would do so if we came up with an application that would need it. And we had considered things like, for example, telescoping supports or things along those lines. But just basically because they weren't necessary, we hadn't done them just yet. But I think they would be very feasible to do so. Now, the other question about origami, the other question about origami is also extremely pertinent. And the there in our mind, it's really one of just the difficulty of mechanical design, because in the end, we do have to cram this into a combined space. And so I personally don't have enough experience with origami. Maybe one of the other speakers could speak to that about how challenging or easy it would be to create a mechanism of this length with this much of a compression with, for example, the load that would be needed to maintain at each of the hinges in the origami. I think there's probably lots of solutions to this problem.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah. One more question from Vinzi, who asks whether the deformation of the system would occur when the load is relatively large, thus affecting the motion accuracy. Maybe you started to touch on this with Jeff's question, but maybe if you want to expand.
Yeah, it's absolutely true. There's really no doubt that if one adds a load at the end, this device acts in one sense like a somewhat stiff nonlinear spring. And those equations of the helix do not hold exactly anymore. A question that's just as important in our mind is how much does that end up mattering? And that's something that we left for future work, partially because of this whole idea of maybe a stress analysis or some simulations would answer that question for us, but also because our observations were more or less that it's kind of close and maybe that's fine. In particular, for something like soft or flexible robots that are mobile, if we're operating under this hypothesis that maybe those motions don't need to be like exactly precise, but maybe because this robot is soft or flexible, it can tolerate some imprecision with its environment, that maybe the simple model is fine. And it's one that's probably more about application rather than something that would need to be examined a priori about the approach in the first place. But again, to be determined.
All right, thanks. Very nice work, Drew. I think we'll clap for you and kick it back over to Haijun.
Okay, I think the next one, that's can we have a good photo? Maybe if you have a camera, turn on your camera and we can take a picture. I think I just take a screenshot, I guess. Okay, let me if it's okay, we can take a photo of everybody and then we can take a photo of the speaker and organizer only. Okay, let's take a photo for everybody. Okay. Hang on a second, okay. Okay, this speaker, can we speaker and organizer only? Wow, I can't. Okay, that's fine. Yeah, I don't know how to I don't know how to make this work. Okay. Okay, I'm done with the group photo. So next one, we can go to the gathering tongue. Fat, can you introduce how to use this gathering tongue? Because I'm in there, I'm actually kind of lost. I don't know how to use it, actually.
Yeah, sure. Happy to talk about it. So folks, when you click on the link, you will join a room. It's a virtual room where you can use your keyboard arrow keys to move around. And when you are close to someone, once you are within a small distance, you are actually connected as if you are in a Zoom call with them. But let's say you want to talk to someone else, you can go far away using your arrow keys. And then when you reach someone else, then you can talk to them. It's kind of like a conference, but in a virtual environment. So if I will be there, and if you have any questions, just come close to me and we can connect over the video call and talk about it. Thanks.
So it's like you have a kind of a few rooms, right? You can go
yes.
there and then only the people in that room can hear and interact each other, right? Is that right?
Only the people who are very close to you, who are standing next to you.
Okay.
In that room. Yeah.
All right. Got it. Okay.
Great. So maybe people can click on the link and we'll see you there. Thanks, everyone.
Okay. Thank you. I'm here already, so.